And I'd like to get the show started off tonight by introducing a couple of people to get us going. From Katie, the Executive Director, Deb Narrow, please come join us. And Bill Clark from the Plymouth Rotary. And I usually say, please no dancing in the aisles for guys like this, okay?
Thanks so much, Brooks. Good evening. As Brooks says, I'm Deb Narrow, Executive Director of C.A.D.Y, and this is Bill Clark. He's the incoming President of Plymouth Rotary. It's our pleasure to welcome you to teach our children well the truth about drugs. Regardless of your role, if you're a parent, a professional, or a community member, we share one common goal. We all want the best for our kids. Yet we find ourselves living in a time where addiction is stealing the lives of our young people. Why is this tragic epidemic happening, and what can we do about it? We'll be exploring these questions this evening, as well as looking at solutions. We have a powerful program lined up for you, and that's including hearing from several people who will share their real-life experiences with addiction. They are telling their stories with the goal of preventing others from taking similar paths. We know this takes tremendous courage, and we are grateful for their leadership on this very serious issue. We'll also hear from statewide and local experts on resources available to parents to prevent substance misuse, and where to get help if someone you love or care about is struggling with substance use disorders. By coming together tonight, we are empowering our community to learn more about the serious nature of addiction and the power of prevention. Our collective goal is to raise awareness around the risks of all drug misuse so we can prevent addiction and save lives. Addressing this deadly epidemic begins with prevention, following by educating ourselves about the disease of addiction and increasing compassion within our community to ensure those struggling with addiction get the help they need to recover. Before I hand this off to Bill to acknowledge our sponsors, I want to recognize a special person, Dawn Lemieux. Dawn is an example of community leadership. She's a local business owner and a member of our Rotary Club who responded to our call to action. She reached out to me last July to share how distressed she was over the opiate epidemic and said she wanted to do something about it. Teach Our Children Well is the direct result of her outreach. I always say, how many people does it take to make a difference? The answer is one. And that one tonight is Dawn Lemieux. Thank you, Dawn. And of course, we have sponsors that we'd like to acknowledge, and I'm going to let Bill do that.
Thank you, Deb.
You're very welcome.
It is my pleasure on behalf of the Plymouth Rotary Club and C.A.D.Y to be able to bring this important event to the region. The purpose of Teach Our Children Well is not only to share information, but also to serve as a public display of unity around the issue of substance misuse, prevention, intervention, treatment, and recovery. This event would not have been possible without the support of the Plymouth Rotary Club, C.A.D.Y, the Rotary Club of Bristol, Speer Memorial Hospital, Mid-State Health Center, The Common Man, The Flying Monkey, Venture Print Unlimited, and Stand Up Newfound. Their support has made this evening possible and will also bring a similar event to the Newfound region later on this fall. I'd just like to thank you all for participating as well, and hope you are able to take home some valuable information from tonight. Thank you.
Thank you, Bill, and to all of the Plymouth Rotarians for being such a strong supporter of C.A.D.Y over the years. We truly appreciate it. And now I have the honor to introduce one of my favorite people, our first speaker, Timothy Rourke. Tim serves on a statewide level as the chair of the Governor's Commission on Alcohol, Drug Abuse Prevention, Intervention, Treatment, and Recovery. Professionally, he works as the Director of Substance Use Disorders, Grant Making, and Strategic Initiatives for the New Hampshire Charitable Foundation. I believe Tim is one of the leading authorities in the state of New Hampshire and beyond on policy issues and practice in the substance use disorders field. I also think he's one of the best speakers I've ever heard. I'm thrilled that he is with us this evening to share his expertise and passion on this topic. Tim lives in Bedford with his wife, Mel, and they have two children, a son 11 years old and a 4-year-old daughter. So he understands the meaning and impact on families as well. And as a side benefit, he has also agreed to serve as this evening's MC. And I call him the MC extraordinaire, so I'm really thrilled that he's willing to play that role, because there's a lot of moving parts here. So it takes somebody experienced to get it done. So please help me welcome Tim Rourke.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you very much. I know that there are any number of other places you could be on this rainy evening, but you've decided to spend them with us. And for that, I think collectively, all of the folks who put tonight together are incredibly grateful. So I want to thank everybody for coming out tonight. I want to thank the Rotary and Katie. The foundation has been a proud funder of the work of Katie for a number of years on a number of projects, and we just couldn't be more thrilled to continue to support their work. So I just want to thank you all very much and thank them for putting this great evening together. I want to just set the stage a little bit and talk about the context of what brings us here tonight. You know, I think it's if you didn't know what was going on, you wouldn't be here. So I want to talk for a second about fear. Because this epidemic that you're hearing about, that you may be living with or experiencing in your community, is scary. And it should be. We've lost a lot of folks to the disorder of addiction due to the opiate epidemic. But those tragedies are just the tip of a bigger iceberg, because the state of New Hampshire has had a substance abuse epidemic for the last 30 years. Now, why is that? I think there are a couple of things that are important for people to understand. New Hampshire is often ranked the best state in the nation to raise children in, the healthiest state in the nation. I, as was said earlier, am a parent. I choose to live in this state, to raise my children in this state, because I believe that is true. But yet you peel that back a little bit, and we find out some things are different. The state of New Hampshire has had the highest rates of substance use disorder of any state in the United States for the last 30 years. While the opiate epidemic may appear new in the media, the substance abuse epidemic underlying it is not. Next slide, please. In addition to folks who are struggling and trying to find ways to get well, their chances at getting well in New Hampshire are particularly challenged, because we have less treatment available in New Hampshire than almost any other state in the United States. In fact, if you are someone or the family member or loved one who is seeking treatment, the only other state in the US you're less likely to get help is Texas. Next slide, please. Now, it would be really easy, with that sort of dark tone, to put this evening in the negative, that we're going to spend tonight talking about how bad the problem is. But I'm going to suggest that I'm fairly confident you get how bad the problem is. And I've been talking in communities all over the state of New Hampshire, and we are beginning to see a change where people are less interested in talking about the problem and more interested in talking about and acting on solutions. So tonight, you're going to see some of the solutions that are going to be that are being put in place. You're going to hear from experts and leaders who are putting those solutions on the ground. You're going to hear from families impacted by this issue who are taking their anger, their grief, the power of their story, and using it to inform and influence how we respond to this epidemic. I've been in the field for 30 years, and I have never seen anything like this picture that you see behind you. 500 people who showed up at the State House on an April day last year to demand resources for treatment, prevention, and recovery supports. And these individuals have been joined by legions of people in recovery, friends, families, allies, treatment providers, prevention specialists, educators, the faith community, and law enforcement, rallying over the last couple of years in ways we have never seen before. So it's my hope and our hope that as we go through tonight, you leave feeling empowered, that this is not an epidemic with no end, but the end is coming, that this is not an overwhelming challenge that we don't know what to do about, but then instead, we know exactly what we need to do. As a state, we know what we need to do. As healthcare systems and other stakeholder sectors, we know what we need to do. And most importantly, for you as parents, there are actually things you can do that can not only support your loved ones who may be struggling to find that help, to sustain that help, but also to make sure that we achieve the goal of a new generation of young adults and young people in the state of New Hampshire who do not have to go through the epidemic we see happening in our state right now, that we can actually prevent it and cut it off at the pass. And what we know is the things that are in place are beginning to work. This is the Youth Risk Behavior Survey. It is a survey that is administered every other year by the Centers for Disease Control. You can't probably read the small print if you're way in the back, but I will tell you what this means. And this is statewide data, so it's not specific to Plymouth or this region, but this is statewide. Statewide, since 2011, youth substance abuse is dropping. It is dropping at a statistically significant level across almost all of the drugs that we track. This is critically important because that's not happening in a lot of other states. And in fact, when New Hampshire got this data back, the CDC called the data analysts because they thought it was a mistake. And it's not. And it's not because everywhere across the state of New Hampshire, nights like this happen. Coalitions like Katie are coming together, bringing in families and parents, law enforcement, educators, and other stakeholders to take back our communities, to take this issue by the horns, and actually do something about it. So that is why I feel actually very confident and really excited to be able to come together and talk about how this region, how this community is going to see itself out of this. Because I think if you leave tonight feeling a sense of hopelessness, a sense of unsurety about what to do, we collectively have missed the point. But this is hopefully a night where we can celebrate the work that's being done, share with you some of the knowledge that we and these experts you're going to hear from have about what works, and make sure that you feel armed and empowered as a member of this community and of this great state to be part of the solution. So, with that, that's my soapbox, and now it's time to really bring in the folks that I really want you to hear from, which are some of the great experts and leaders and voices of this issue that are leading the conversation in this community and will lead it with you tonight. So you're going to hear first from my very good friend Susan McCune. I've known Susan for years. She is a vocal, eloquent person on these issues. She is a parent, a published author, and is one of the leaders that has launched 1,000 ships, parent support groups that exist all over the state of New Hampshire, helping parents who are struggling with children who are struggling with this issue. And I know she has very powerful information to share. So with that, it is my great pleasure to introduce to you Susan McCune.
Thank you. It is always great to share a stage with Tim. And I want to thank Katie, Deb, Polly, Liz, and the whole Katie team for putting this gathering together tonight, along with the woman who was motivation behind it. And it really is wonderful that you've chosen to come out. Do you have that for me, just so I can... Excuse me 1 minute. I wanted a light. I wanted a podium, but it didn't have a light, just so I could... Not giving me much light up here. And I didn't do PowerPoint. Anyway, I'm going to talk to parents for 10 minutes on things. As Tim said, there are things that you can do as a parent, and that's the positive thing. We're already seeing by the statistic that there are some very exciting things going on. Thank you very much. We'll see how that goes. So, yeah, you know what it's like. Who's over 40 here? Okay. So whether or not your child is having problems right now with drugs or alcohol, you're undoubtedly concerned about what you hear out there, what you may be facing, and you're trying to figure out how to avoid it. And good for you for being here. You know, as a prevention person, I always start with prevention because it's always easier to prevent something than it is to fix it after it becomes a problem. Drug use doesn't happen overnight. We all know this. And that's, again, where the exciting part of prevention is, that there are things that we can do to recognize it and hopefully prevent, intervene, and get help early. One of the first things that we can do as parents, there's a whole push out there for lock it up. How many of you have heard of that? Not that I can see your hands, a few of you. Lock it up means all medications and all alcohol in your home should be locked up. Now, the first time I heard that, and as a nurse practitioner, I had to promote that, but I thought it sounded very controlling. This is our environment, right? We should be able to have those things accessible where we want them. I will tell you that as a person in my own home, I have been burned by that twice on people that were staying in my home that were good people that I did not recognize had a problem with some depression and suicide and alcohol. And you know, shame on you, twice shame on me. Okay, so as a parent, I will tell you, lock it up. Being informed as a parent and being involved really makes a difference with your children. It starts with modeling the kind of behavior that you want to see with your child. Every once in a while, it's a great question to ask yourself, what's it like to have me for a mother or father? How am I? It's great. Yeah, that's a good answer. That's what we want to hear. They're very lucky to have me. What's it like to have me as a parent? It's difficult to raise children these days, and I do think it is more of a challenge. We have four children. They're older now. They're out of the home. They're independent. And sometimes I think, although we did deal with these issues, which is obviously why I'm up here as a parent, but in many ways I feel like we scraped by because a lot of things weren't quite as challenging as they are now. Today with technology, you can't as a parent keep up with things 24/7. That's really, really difficult. Boundaries are needed, and as parents, we have to set them and you have to enforce them. That's not always fun and it's not always easy. It rarely is. Your child should not like you very much right now and during the teen years. You should be considered pretty much of a jerk and you should be a source of embarrassment. Just ride through it. You won't always be a jerk, although you will be a source of embarrassment for a long time. It's only important that you know you're not a jerk, okay? That you know why you're doing the tough things that you're doing for your child. You're just doing your job, and when your child says that you are the only parent who is making me come home at 9 o'clock, or whatever the issue is, sometimes that might be true. Maybe you sadly are the only parent that's saying that. But you can just smile. Don't get pulled into the verbal volleyball game. Just say, you're right, I know it's tough, but that is my job right now. I do it because I love you, and don't worry, it won't last forever. If you're your child's best friend right now, that's a problem. Okay, your child is going to have a lot of friends in their lifetime. They're only going to have one parent. Be that parent. Be the adult that your child really needs you to be. predisposition to drugs in families, it runs just like diabetes and heart disease, and that's one of the things we really need to recognize. Are we talking to our kids about family medical history? Do they know about Aunt Susie's problem with drinking? Do they know about Uncle Harry's cocaine use? These are things that should be talked about. We don't have to be demeaning to the person, but to recognize and share with our children that this is part of the medical history, and therefore they are at risk, just like we would talk to them about other diseases. Be open and factual about your talking. You're also letting them know that it's okay to talk to you about these subjects. A really important thing to do, you're giving your kids permission to talk to you. Listen to your kids. The car is a great place. I think every parent kind of realizes that. Get them trapped in the car, they can't go anywhere. It's really terrific if you can get a bunch of kids in the car and, you know, they start talking among themselves. They all of a sudden, you just become invisible to them. It's terrific. And if you just shut up and listen, you will hear an awful lot of stuff that goes down. If you're alone with them, use a third-person approach. You're listening to the radio. You're watching a news on TV. You're reading a newspaper article. Pull them into it. Say, wow, what do you think of that? What would you do if you were in that situation? How would you handle it if a friend of yours got into a problem like that? Who would you go talk to? You know, it doesn't always have to be me. I know sometimes it's hard to talk to a parent about some things. But do you have some other adult, your coach or a guidance counselor at school that you could talk to? Get them thinking about that. Understand that our kids in our world today are stressed. And one of the gals that does the YRBS that Tim was referring to here, that really came out that the stress part of it was really something that kids were talking about. We think as adults we're busy and we're stressed. We're not the only ones. Our kids are stressed. And we've got to acknowledge that for them. And some of them are stressed at school, some of them are stressed because they know what's going on with their friends, and some of them are stressed about some of the stuff that's going on in our own homes. They talk about it as one of the reasons that they seek marijuana is to lessen the stress for themselves. So we can't eliminate all the stresses in our kids' life, but again, if we can recognize it and acknowledge it, we can teach them techniques that could help them deal with stress. Share some of the stresses that you have, you know, and what you do for it. And if you're not doing enough for yourself, then this is a good time to pull in some stuff for family. And one important area that you can work on is limiting media exposure. 24/7, they get it. Most kids have a cell phone. They've got video games at home. A lot of them have TVs in their room. You know, and when you mention to parents about limiting it, they go, really? Yes. Yes, you can. You can say, you know what? We really need to cut down on the time here. And for all of us, 2 hours before bed, we're not supposed to be doing any screen time because it interferes with our sleep. So certainly kids could get rid of some of that, do some reading, listen to some music before they go to sleep. A lot of times we parents are crashing, we're exhausted, and our kids are up on their cell phones, playing their video games, watching TV in their room many, many hours into the night, which is really depriving them of a lot of sleep. We know that exercise, 8 hours of sleep, balanced meals, activity, exercise, yoga, meditation, all help bring stress hormones down. We know that for everybody. It's good for kids. It's good for adults. Having family dinner together every night. Now, that's something that's hard to set the clock by. If you have a couple of kids, you know, they're often in other activities and sports and music and what have you, and you get home work late. Dinner can't always be on the clock like Leave It to Beaver Land at 6 o'clock every night. But you know what? Have dinner together as a family. Use it as your touch point, talking about the thorns and the roses, okay, the good parts of the day, and what was the hard part of the day for you. You can share your own thorns and roses of the day, and it gives an opportunity to talk and touch base with your kids. So none of this is rocket science, okay? It's stuff that we can do as adults. We can teach it to our children. And have regular activities in these areas. But both adults and children can benefit with that. Nothing can give you 100% guarantee that your child is not going to do drugs, but a lot of the stuff here is research-based that if you can do and incorporate some of this stuff with your family, you're going to be a lot less apt to have it. So know some of the warning signs. There's plenty of information out there. Listen to your children. And go also by your gut. Your gut will often tell you something that your heart may not want to hear. Seek help. Ask questions. There are a lot of people that are wondering and worried about the same things that you are, and we're going to talk more about that on the panel. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Susan. All right. So I'm really excited to introduce to you what comes next. We're going to give you a little performance of something called Alex's Story. And it is based on the life of a young person named Alex, an actual true story of someone's struggles with substance use disorders and ultimate recovery. I will say that I have known Alex, who this play is based on, for a couple of years now. And his story has resonated across the state of New Hampshire. But for anybody sharing their recovery story, you can share it a couple of times, but sharing it a lot can get a little redundant. So Alex and his family, with Katie and the Tiger Theater program at Plymouth State, came up with an incredibly innovative idea to turn his story into a one-actor performance. So you're actually going to not meet Alex, at least not yet. You're going to meet Tegan, the young woman who is going to bring his story to life for you. I will say I have seen her perform this. She did it in front of a legislative committee, wowed the committee, and it led to a bill, Senate Bill 535, sponsored by Senator Jeanne Forrester. I'm not sure she's here tonight, but that bill seeks to make funding available to every high school in the state to bring this theater performance to them. That bill passed the Senate. It is now in the House, and it is because of the brave courage of Alex, Tegan, Katie, Plymouth State's Tiger Theater Program, Senator Forrester, and so many others. So you are going to meet Tegan. I'd like to invite her to the stage. She will perform Alex's story for you, and then there will be a bit of Q&A, and you will actually meet Alex himself after the performance. Thanks.
Hi. I'm Alex, and I'm a recovering addict. I'm here today because I sat in the seat of high schoolers just a couple of years ago thinking that could never happen to me. But I'm not that different from any of you, and I'm here to tell you that it can happen. I'm here to share my story with you. Before I started using, I had a lot of advantages in life. I was involved in scouts and sports, stuff like that. I had a really great family. Life was pretty good. You know, there were no real problems that I had. Then I got into middle school, and that's kind of where things started changing. I was hanging out with all different sorts of people, whether it was the jocks or the nerds or what have you, and I started hanging out more and more with my friends from up the street. Those friends were the ones who introduced me to marijuana for the first time. The first time I used, I was at my friend's house, and he was like, you know, hey, do you want to try this? And I said, sure. And you know, from there I started smoking a couple times a month, just once or twice a month, not a lot, and just when I was hanging out with those friends, so you know, it wasn't a really big deal. But then, after a while, in my eighth grade year, I was smoking every single day after school. And you know, I was introduced to different things, prescription benzos like Xanax and Valium and stuff like that. After a while, I was introduced to alcohol, and you know, I liked drinking a lot. I would steal beers from my parents or get my friends who were 21 to buy me some. It just got to the point where whatever I could do to get messed up, I would do, whether it was drinking, smoking, or taking pills. Freshman year is where my parents really found out about my addiction. I had smoked before school. I went to school and got suspended for being under the influence in school. So, you know, now my parents knew that I was smoking and that I had a problem with marijuana. They wanted me to get help, so they brought me to this counselor, psychologist of some sort, and, well, you know, I hated the guy. I couldn't stand him. I thought that I knew everything, and I didn't want to listen to him. I was just smoking pot. It's not a big deal. So I stopped seeing him, and I continued smoking. But then it started to get worse. When I was 16, I got really drunk, and I blacked out and was basically left for dead on the side of the road. Now most people, when that happens, would, you know, want to stop or get help, but I didn't care. I just knew, okay, I can drink that much, and I'll black out. So if I don't drink that much, everything will be okay. I thought that I was in control. A few months after that happened, I was introduced to Percocet for the first time, and that's what became my drug of choice. I was at my friend's house, the same one who got me into the weed, and, you know, his brothers were always trying to get us to try this, try that, smoke this, smoke that. And he was like, oh, hey, I have this pill. Do you want to try it? I had known that his brothers were doing it, and it just looked like they were having so much fun, you know? And I was like, I want that. So I said, sure, and I tried it. And I don't know, I can't explain the feeling that it gave me, you know? It made me feel like I was invincible, you know, like I was on top of the world. Little did I know, that pill was going to destroy my life. At the time, I was doing everything, you know, drinking, smoking, taking these pills, and it wasn't a big deal, you know, because it's not like I was snorting cocaine or shooting up heroin. So I was with a friend, a different one, and he showed me this small blue pill called Perc 30s, and I just hit it off with that. You know, I would do anything I could to get it. That little blue pill literally controlled my life from 16 to 17 years old. And I was doing anything I could to get it. I was stealing from my friends, I was stealing from my family, I was taking anything that wasn't bolted to the ground, and I was selling it. All the money that I made at work was just going into drug dealers' pockets, and I didn't think that I had a problem. Yeah, I was just being normal, you know, a normal teenager, doing what normal teenagers do, you know? One day, I was in the wrong place at the wrong time, and I got in the middle of a fight. And, you know, I kind of freaked out. So I went to the school resource officer, and I told him, you know, I'm getting beat up. And then I just spilled my guts, and I told him that I really have a problem, and I need help. So they took me from school, and they brought me to the hospital, where I got blood tested. Well, the thing was, the only thing that I tested positive for was marijuana, and there was nothing else in my system. So, I mean, that was basically the end of that. Yeah, I don't know if my parents just brushed it under the rug, or they thought that I was being sincere when I said that I didn't want to use anymore. The real reason definitely wasn't that I didn't want to use anymore. I just didn't want to get beat up, you know? So I continued using. And then it got a lot worse. The same person that introduced me to the Perc 30s introduced me to heroin. The first time I used, I was at this friend's house, and he had it out on some tinfoil. And I was like, what's that? It's heroin. He said, do you want to try it? And I said, sure. And I tried it. And then it just kind of spiraled out of control. I mean, I realized that heroin was cheaper than the perks, which, I mean, was more bang for my buck, but it was like a snowball. You know, once you start it, you can't stop it. It's like you're rolling down this hill, going faster and faster, and there's nothing that you can do to stop it. But, you know, I was like, I can just try this drug. You know, it'll be fine. I don't have to use it for the rest of my life. You know, I won't get addicted to it, because that doesn't happen. You know, I'm not that kind of person. But then I was using it every single day. I was just snorting it, and I was smoking it, and it wasn't enough. You know, I started having dreams about shooting up, and then one day I was like, you know, I'm going to IV this, because everyone else is doing it, and they say that it's so much better. I said the hell with it, and I tried it. And there was no going back after that. That was the summer of 2013, and I was doing it every single day, you know, still stealing from anybody that I could, my sister, my little brother, anyone that I could get money from. I was just taking it, you know, and I tried to tell myself that I didn't have a conscience. I tried to tell myself that it doesn't matter if that's your family's money, because you're going to get messed up. You'll feel great later, and you'll forget all about it. You know, it doesn't matter if they need that money for food, because you're going to get messed up, and that's what matters. I still didn't think that I had a problem. You know, I still thought that I was in control. Then, in October of 2013, my friend told me via text that he stole his stepdad's iPad. And, you know, I was mad at him about bunch of other things, but this just, well, it pushed me over the edge. You know, I was ticked. So I sent the text that he sent to me, and I sent it to his mom, who then showed the police, and the police showed up at our school. So I was pretty much forced to tell my parents. Well, I told my mom. My dad found out later, a few days later on his 26th wedding anniversary. So now my parents knew that I really had a problem with opiates, and now I was shooting up dope. They had no idea. You know, they were completely clueless. Anyways, they sent me to another counselor, a new one, and I just put on this charade, you know, that I was okay. I could get through this. Yeah, I just needed the support of my family and my friends, and everything would be fine. You know, I could just smoke weed, not take pills, or shoot up heroin, and everything would be okay, you know? But in reality, I was just like, this counselor guy has absolutely no idea what he's talking about. I'm still using, and he has no idea. He's an idiot. I'm totally fooling this guy, and it's so easy. Flash forward to January 7th, the last day I used heroin. I made a decision that changed my life. I was sitting in my room, and I don't know, something came over me. I realized that, I mean, I had lost countless friends. I'd ruined the relationship that I had with my family. I was a nobody. You know, I had nothing good going on in my life, and yeah, I could die if I continued like this. So I told my brother and my sister that I was still using, and I gave my dad all of my paraphernalia, and 6 days later, I was admitted to my first rehab in Brockton, Mass. It's known as the Castle. I spent 2 weeks there, and they really changed my life because they showed me that you don't need to put a substance in your body in order to enjoy life, which was, I mean, kind of the biggest thing for me, you know, because I've been using for 5 years since I was 13 years old, and I didn't know how to watch TV without being messed up or even just go on a walk and enjoy it without being messed up. I didn't know how to do anything and enjoy it without being high. And rehab showed me that you don't need drugs in order to enjoy your life. So after 2 weeks there, I was transferred to the Phoenix House in Dublin, New Hampshire. And at first, I was a little hesitant to go. You know, I was telling myself, I don't need to go. You know, I can do this on my own. You know, I don't need to go to some month-long rehab where they're just going to tell me the same crap that they told me at the Castle. You know I'm going to get sober, so why do I need to go to that place for it? But what I realized is that was the same thinking that I was using when I was in active addiction. You know, that was the same thinking that I was using when I was using. And I knew that I had to change that. You know, I knew that I had to do something different. I knew that I had to do something that would make me uncomfortable in order to stay in recovery. So I was moved to the Phoenix House on January 27th of 2014 and was there until March 21st of 2014. And I found that I was wrong. You know, I really learned a lot there. And the most important thing is that I got clean time. You know, there was no one around me who was going to suck me back into using. Those friends, they were out of my life for good. And, you know, I met a lot of really interesting people, and I learned a lot about myself. And I ended up growing a passion for sobriety. If you're smoking weed, that's a big warning sign. You know, that's a problem. Marijuana is a gateway drug, just in two ways. The first is that gives you the experience of being high, and you know, you might want to chase that high, so you might go elsewhere to find it. The second is that it puts you around harder drugs. the same person that you get your weed from, they can probably get you Xanax or Valium or alcohol or heroin or who knows what else. You know, smoking weed, it doesn't mean that you're going to want to do other drugs. But it does put you around other drugs. And you might be sitting there thinking, no, I'm different. But you're not different, because every single person who uses drugs says that. You know, every single person who uses drugs says, I don't have a problem. But, you know, it's the ones who say that they do have a problem and get help who usually get better. And it can happen to anyone. You know, no one is exempt from being an addict. You could be a big CEO or from a broken home family. It doesn't matter. You know, you could have everything in life and still be an addict. But and there is help, you know. There are people who want to see you recover. I had people who wanted to help me recover, and look at where I am now. The tools that I wish I had then that I have now are, one, the realization of the fact that drugs really are as bad as people say they are. Two, the willpower to say no, even when it's extremely hard. And three, the acceptance of the fact that I don't need to care so much about what other people think. You know, if I hadn't cared so much when I was 13, I probably wouldn't have gotten into drugs. You know, I would have been doing whatever I wanted to do without the use of drugs. There's so much more to life than drugs. You know, there are no winners when you use drugs. You can land one of three places: jails, institutions, or death. And none of those seem very fun. Once you're an addict for life. I will always be in recovery. You don't recover. It's like when a cucumber becomes a pickle. You know, once it's a pickle, there's no going back to being a cucumber. You are what you are. And once you accept that and get the help that you need, the better, because it only gets worse. And there is no such thing as a recreational hard drug user. You can't occasionally use a hard drug and then say that you don't have a problem. So if you're sitting there thinking, I don't have a problem, know that you might be wrong. You know, that might be the addiction talking. Or if you're sitting there and you've never used drugs before, still just be on the lookout. You know, don't make the same mistakes that I did. You see, brains are wired so that once you start, it's extremely hard to stop. It's an extremely hard fight. But with the right support system and rehab, it is possible to recover, and it's worth it. Thank you.
Hello. My name is Tegan Kelly, and I work with Tiger and Katie on this project. And I'd now like to introduce you to Alex Berry himself.
Hey, everybody. I'm Alex. I'm your pickle, or addict, as you might refer to me as. I'm so grateful to be here. You know, I come to a lot of high schools, and this is the most unique high school I've been to so far. there's that. and I find it ironic that this place is called the Flying Monkey, because the fact that my dad's here, because you guys all know the Wizard of Oz. It's a great movie. But my dad is terrified of flying monkeys, you know, and he came in here today. So thank you, Dad. I appreciate that for coming in. So I hope you guys enjoy Tegan's performance, because I know when I hear it, it's like eating a slice of humble pie. Just imagine someone coming up on a stage and telling everything bad that you've ever done. You know, it's like it's humbling, but it's great at the same time because, you know, I know the end, I get to help out other people so they don't have to go through the same thing. So let's give another round of applause for Tegan because she did a great job.
Thank you. So now what we usually do when we're at our high schools is that we send around index cards and we let high schoolers ask questions that they want to. Of course, we have to monitor it a little bit. But we've collected many questions from many amazing questions from many high schools. So what we're going to do now is actually ask Alex some of those questions. What led to your addiction? Was there peer pressure, other influences involved?
So a lot of things led to my addiction. One of the biggest things was curiosity and opportunity. I guess those were two things. So those things went hand in hand with each other. And so basically how it started, you guys know, is I was up the street with some friends and they had some older brothers and then this led to that and so on and so forth. But I was just so curious about, you know, what it was like. Because, you know, I had D.A.R.E. programs, and they told us all the dangers of drugs and why they were so bad. But they never went and told you how it was like to get high. Because why would they do that? That doesn't make any sense. And what I saw from the people that, you know, were using is they were having so much fun, you know, and they weren't, like, dead or anything. They were having a fun time. And I wanted that, you know. So the curiosity of it and the opportunity went hand in hand. And, you know, that's how it started.
Being a recovering heroin addict, do you avoid all drugs, illegal prescription, alcohol, and tobacco?
Yeah. I feel like that's the best way to do it because, well, for one, if I'm taking prescription drugs that weren't prescribed to me or drinking alcohol, I'm not exactly sober. So, and as for the tobacco and, you know, other drugs like that, it's just, it's not worth it. It's not worth it to myself. I do take Tylenol and things like that for when I have a headache or a sore throat like I do now. So, there is that.
Did you go through intense withdrawals after you stopped using?
Yeah, I did. You know, when you use a drug like heroin for an extended period of time, you know, you become addicted to it, obviously, and become dependent, and it becomes like you can't function without it. And when you don't have it, you're sick. And that's half the reason why you're going to get your next fix. So it was awful, you know. I felt like complete crap.
How important was it to have a positive, strong support system during treatment and recovery?
Insanely important. You know, my family and my support network were the ones that got me into rehab. You know, they were the ones that never gave up on me. They were the ones that visited me when I was in rehab. They were the ones that took me on my passes when I was in my rehab. They're the ones that I went back to after I got out of rehab. And they're still here today. They, you know, they were like one of the most, if not the most important things to me. You know, for my recovery.
How were the relationships around you affected by your heroin use?
Tremendously. They were affected tremendously, mostly negatively. You know, like with all the lying and the stealing and the cheating, you know, that's no good way to, you know, have a relationship with anybody. So they, you know, I destroyed relationships. But through my recovery, I was able to build those relationships back up, and they were able to be stronger than ever. However, there are still some relationships in my life that I haven't been able to patch up, and it's very difficult for me. You know, it's been 26 months since I got sober, and you know, my little brother, he still won't talk to me, and it's so difficult, and it's hard to understand because I'm the one that caused all the pain. You know, I don't know what it's like to feel all that pain. You know, I can imagine that it kind of, it's like this. You know, him, he's 3 years younger than me. You know, I'm 20 and he's 17. So we grew up pretty close together. So I guess in a sense, I was a role model to him. You know, when we were growing up playing, you know, baseball in the backyard or basketball or manhunt or whatever. And then all of a sudden, I go into middle school, and I start experimenting with drugs and alcohol, and by the time I'm in high school, like, I'm a full-blown junkie, as most people saw me as. And that kind of, that must have destroyed him, you know, like, I was supposed to be, like, a role model and an important figure in this, in my brother's life, and I destroyed it, you know. And it's difficult, but I understand that, you know, with as long as I stay on this path, eventually, you know, I can mend that relationship and we can be close again.
How has your drug use changed you?
Well, it changed everything in my life. You know, I started using when I was about 13. And before that, I was a really good student. And I was, you know, a talkative individual. I hung out with a lot of people from various crowds. I was involved in sports, Cub Scouts, stuff like that. And then, you know, I started using. My grades dropped. I stopped playing sports. Stopped going to Boy Scouts. I isolated myself a lot more. I hung out with less people, so it just, like, I withdrew from everything, you know. The only thing that I wanted to do was get high, you know. I didn't want to play baseball. I didn't want to play basketball. I just wanted to get high. And my grades suffered so much, too. I went from an A and B student to someone who just did the bare minimum to get by because that's all, you know, I didn't want to try hard, you know.
Why are you having a female telling your story?
Because you're awesome, Tegan. That's why. You know? Now, we have the female because, you know, it shows that addiction isn't just male, it isn't just female, it's both, you know? It can be anybody, you know? It doesn't matter who it is.
What is heroin like?
Heroin is awful, but it's, you know, I say that, but I used it a lot, and you know, the best way that I can describe heroin is like a warm, evil blanket that suffocates you, consumes your mind, your body, and your soul, and it kind of lulls you into sleep. And for some individuals, you don't wake up from that sleep. And if you do wake up from that sleep, odds are you're sick, and you're wanting more, and you're just obsessed with it. Just getting back to that sleep, getting back to that blanket, chasing that dragon. And it's warm, but it's so evil.
In a student's perspective, what do I do if I think my friends are socializing with people addicted to drugs and might be influenced in that direction?
Well, the number one thing you got to do is keep yourself safe, you know? The number two thing is, you might want to tell an adult, someone that is equipped to handle something like that, because the burden shouldn't just be on you. It should be on, you know, maybe an authority figure that you trust. I mean, I'm not saying go tell their parents, but maybe if you can confide in someone that you trust enough, and you know, you might be able to help them before they really begin to hurt themselves. You know, you might end up saving their lives. You know, see something, say something.
Do people treat you differently when they find out that you're a recovering heroin addict?
Yeah, they definitely do. They're shocked most of the time because I think most people have a stigma of what a heroin addict looks like. And I guess I don't fit that criteria. I might have when I was using, but after 26 months cleaning up my act a little bit, I guess I don't resemble the stigma heroin addict anymore. Most people are proud and congratulate me on my struggle, my overcoming my addiction, this, that, and the other thing. And, you know, no one's ever really looked down on me for, which is great.
What do you do to stay in recovery?
I do a lot of things. For one, I don't use drugs. That's the number one thing. Don't use no matter what. The next thing is I have a great support network. You know, I got a loving family. Great friends, go to NA meetings, you know. But the family is the biggest one for me, you know. I'm able to talk to my parents about anything that I want. Back in the day, I didn't talk to them about anything except for, can I have this? Can I have that? Can you bring me here? Can you bring me there? You know. But now I can talk to them about, you know, like, Dad, I'm having a pretty rough day, or I had a rough week, you know, work was awful because X, Y, and Z, and I feel crummy because this and that, you know. And that's great. You know, it really helps me being able to talk about my emotions that I never was able to talk about anymore.
How long does it take to get addicted to something?
Well, that, you know, it's such a, there's no set amount of times. It could be the first time, it could be the 100th time, you know, like, it's really when you decide, it's really when, I don't even know how to answer that question. You know, there's no way to tell how long it takes to get addicted to something.
Can addiction run in your family?
Yeah. Susan was talking about it, you know, and it's good to know if it does, you know, to tell your kids that it, you know, it runs in the family, and it's something that that could happen to them. You know, it definitely does. It doesn't have to, but, you know, a lot of things that I've noticed is that when I go to the high schools, well, some of the students come up after me and, you know, talk to me face to face, and they say, oh, my brother, you know, has an issue with drugs or an alcohol, and I see it every day, but I don't have a problem because I understand how, you know, I see them and I don't want to be like that.
How did your parents find out, how did your parents not find out when you were using, and what did they do when they found out?
Well, they found out like little pieces at a time. I was like picking up breadcrumbs until they got to that house or whatever happens in Hansel and Gretel. So, like, the first time they found out I was smoking pot because I got caught at high school. And, you know, my mom was all freaking out. Like, oh, no, he's smoking weed. My dad's like, eh, whatever, he's smoking pot, so what? So, you know, my dad... I'm sorry, Dad, I'm embarrassing you a lot today. I hope you... you know, I won't introduce you to anybody. But, no, like, see, so my mom freaked out and thought it was the end of the world, which, you know, it could have been. It wasn't, because I'm here now and I'm okay. So they found out, like, little piece by piece. And so the first thing that they found out was weed. My mom brought me to the counselor. My dad was kind of like, you shouldn't smoke weed, but you're going to do what you're going to do. Don't let your mother find out. This, that, and the other thing, you know, because he didn't think that I was going to, you know, go down the path that I did. And then, you know, the next thing they found out was the alcohol. And that's, like, when my sister started to, like, scream and yell and get in everybody's face about, like, he could have died, he needs to get his stomach pumped. My dad actually made me run around the block when I had alcohol poisoning. That's how he fixed me, so. Thanks, Dad. And then they found out about the opiates, you know, that I had tried heroin once or twice. And that's when I had to sit down with my older siblings, and we cried over some steak at the 99, and it kind of went away from there, you know? Like, they believed me when I said I didn't want to use anymore, this, that, and the other thing. And then in October 2013, I was kind of backed into a corner when I, you know, told on my friend for stealing the iPad from his stepdad. You know, I wasn't expecting her to go to the police and the police to come to the school. So I was, like, backed into a corner, and I was like, crap, they're going to tell them because they saw text messages involving heroin in my phone. So they're going to find out one way or another. So I hatched a genius plan of, all right, so I'll just come clean and tell them everything. And once they knew everything, you know, it was, like, it took a little while for me to get into rehab. For one, I didn't want to go, and for two, I think that they just wanted to believe that I was okay. You know, no one wants to think that, you know, their son or daughter has an issue with heroin, you know? Like, you don't want that. You want to believe that they're okay. My sister, on the other hand, well, she was my sister's just a little, well, she's a little crazy, I guess you could say, and she's pregnant now, and she's just even more crazy, but, you know, it happens, right? Yeah, I know. I love her to death, but, yeah, Jesus. Just, anyways, but, you know, my sister, you know, she's older than me. She's 6 years older than me. No, that's a lie. Like, 4 years older than me. And she was like, she's like the middle child with me, because I got an older brother, older sister, me, and my little brother. So me and her are like the middle children, the middle child syndrome, you know. The top one's praised because he's awesome for doing, you know, everything right. The little one's the baby, and he gets away with everything because he's the baby, the princess, as I like to call him. Not to his face, because he's a lot bigger than me now. But anyway, so, like, we always had that closer relationship because, you know, we were close to each other. And, sorry. made me lose my train of thought, sorry. So we were always close to each other. And she was always the one that, she was the one that screamed in my mom's face that I needed to get help, you know, that I needed to go to rehab. And, you know, eventually everything, you know, it was like Jenga. Everything was starting to pile up and pile up and pile up on my conscience. And it all tumbled down and I decided to do something about my life.
So what would you tell a parent that they should do if they're in the same situation that your parents were in?
Well, for one, don't give up. For two, don't stop loving them. For three, don't ignore it. And for four is have hope, because recovery is possible, you know? It is, it really is. And through things like this and all the amazing things that all the amazing people here are doing, you know, we can get it to the people that need it. So thank you for listening to my story. I hope you enjoyed it.
Ladies and gentlemen, Alex Berry and Tegan Kelly. Great. So if our speakers wouldn't mind making their way to the stage while I just sort of give a pulse check on the evening. Everybody doing okay? Yeah? Good. Good. Great. So what we're going to do now, just so you know sort of the flow of what's about to happen, is I'm going to introduce a panel of speakers who are going to talk to you for a little bit. One of the things we recognize is that events like this and conversations on topics like this open up a lot of conversation and a lot of questions. And you heard some of those questions that Alex and Tegan very often get when they perform. So what we're going to do is you're going to hear from this distinguished panel of community leaders and folks on the front lines, and then we'll do a little bit of closing, I'll kind of wrap up, closing comment video, and then our speakers are going to stay, hang around. And so I hope that we want to make sure that people have time for one-on-one conversation, ask those questions you might be thinking about as you're hearing some of this information, and our folks have made themselves available. So we're going to do this panel, we'll kind of close the evening, but then these folks are going to stick around, and I hope you will too, have some conversations. There are also resources and information outside as well. So I just wanted to let you know in terms of how we're going to proceed for the rest of the evening. So my job is just to do quick intros of folks, and then I'm going to walk away so that you can hear from these experts. So, and you'll forgive me because, as was noted, I have young children, so I'm lucky I'm wearing matching socks, let alone I remember everybody's name. So I'm just really thrilled to have these folks here tonight to share with you. So first we're going to hear, we've heard Alex and Alex through Tegan, the story of someone in recovery, of a young person in recovery, but we want to make sure you hear the story from the voices of some parents who have been through this experience. So you're going to hear from Susan Messenger and Janice Maves to start us off. Then you're going to hear from Dr. Viking Hedberg with the Dartmouth-Hitchcock Adolescent Medicine. Viking has been really leading some cutting-edge work, quite frankly, having been a funder of some of his work over the last decade plus around issues of adolescent treatment, so I know he'll have a lot to say. Barbara Kelly from Newfound Regional High School, who serves as the school nurse, who can talk a little bit about that angle of it. Michael Currier from Plymouth Regional High School, is a social worker there at the school. Chief Stephen Lefebvre from Plymouth Police Department, thank you very much. Susan, you heard from earlier, and of course, the region's leader, Deb Narrow, who will kind of wrap up the panel with her thoughts. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to Susan, and thank you very much.
Hi, my name is Susan Messenger, and the worst thing happened to my family on October 23rd, 2014. Our son, Carlton Frederick Messenger II, beloved son of John and Susan Messenger and devoted big brother to Adam Messenger, died of a fentanyl overdose. I've been forced to become a member of an exclusive club that I never wanted to be part of. It was never my plan to bury one of my children due to a drug overdose. This club seems to be growing daily. no parent should ever have to go through this. The system isn't working. We asked ourselves, how does a young adult who is a college graduate taking chemistry and biology classes, getting A's and B's in classes so he can apply to dental school, use heroin? I immediately, when I found out, thought, not my child. There has to be a mistake. How did we miss this? It was decided Carl would go to detox immediately, but that this would be a family secret. Only the four members of our family would know. This could have been anyone's child. The system isn't working if we as a society have to be ashamed of admitting to having this disease. After six phone calls and much frustration, I finally found a detox center that would take my son. The reason for my frustration was not that there wasn't a bed available or they wouldn't take my insurance. The real frustration was when I was told over and over again that if they didn't take our insurance, they could not accept him as a cash-paying customer. Over and over again, I heard this, we don't accept your insurance, and no, we can't see him in detox. You can't pay for it with a credit card. When I questioned why this was going on, what I was told over and over again is their agreement forbade them from taking cash-paying customers. They had been approved to work with certain insurance companies, and the agreement they signed would not allow them to take the cash-paying clients. I finally found a detox center in Manchester. He could enter as a cash-paying inpatient if our insurance denied the request, and as expected, they denied the request. What they told us was if he had had an alcohol issue, it would be covered, but that they didn't feel that drug addiction was a deadly problem, and so they would not cover it. The system is not working. The nurses and doctors at the center told us that we had raised him right, and he didn't belong in the drug detox center. At the time, we thought heroin users live on the street, under bridges, and are contributing members to society. Not true. This disease does not discriminate. On Tuesday, October 21st, 2014, Carl came down with an upper respiratory infection and went to the doctors. He never saw his regular doctor for this visit. He saw a doctor who was not familiar with Carl and the fact that he had just come out of detox for heroin addiction. His primary care physician never wrote in his chart about the heroin addiction and that he had just completed detox, even though we had three different meetings with his doctor. The system isn't working. The doctor never asked him if he had any alcohol or drug abuse issues before prescribing a codeine cough medicine. The medical center had removed the template that would cue the doctor to ask these questions 5 years prior. The system's not working. The pharmacy never put a label on the medicine bottle stating that it contained codeine. The only label on the bottle said is it can make you drowsy. The system isn't working. The Controlled Drug Act does not require that medicine be labeled in this manner. Again, the system's not working. The codeine in the cough medicine triggered his need for opiates. The next day, I found him dead in his bathroom with a syringe still in his hand. Only later did we find out that it was not heroin that he had used. It was 100% fentanyl that killed him instantly. When we got the toxicology report back, there was absolutely no heroin in his system. The system isn't working and is failing our young people. We are losing a whole generation. We must fix the system, and this will take everyone to make this change. Changes I would like to see. When the doctor is writing a prescription, I know many of them ask if you have drug or alcohol issues. And yes, you can easily lie and say, no, I don't. But I'd like to see it taken further for them to let you know if you do have a drug or alcohol issue, what this drug can do as far as making you seek out drugs again if you've been clean for a while. That would have made a difference in Carl's life. I'd like to see all narcotic prescriptions labeled that it's a narcotic and that the drug-seeking behavior it will cause. It would have definitely made a difference in my son's life. All communications regarding a patient health history must be documented in a patient's chart. I was told because I was the mother giving the information to the doctor that he did not have a legal right to have to put it in the chart. Detox and rehab centers must take cash-paying customers. It would have made a difference in many people's lives. All insurance carriers must cover drug and alcohol detox and inpatient rehab. Right now, they don't have to. I'd like to see the physicians limit the number of opiate narcotic pills that can be prescribed at one time and increase the penalty for selling fentanyl. No parent should have to go through what my family and I have gone through, knowing that the next time I will see Carl, who'll be in heaven, and sometimes I pray that that will happen sooner rather than later. Having your 16-year-old son write an essay that he read to the entire student body at New Hampton School that's titled, Now an Only Child, no parent should have to read that. They told me I only had 4 minutes, so I'm assuming my 4 minutes is probably up. So I'm going to pass the microphone to Janice Mays.
It's really hard to know what to say after listening to Susan. I'm the mother of a heroin addict in recovery. And when Deb asked me to come and talk, she said, we'd really like to have you talk about what some of the red flags were that you saw with your son and how you were able to get him into treatment. I would love to be able to say to you that my son came home from school and said, well, Mom, I tried heroin today. It was really fun. And then I would know he was a heroin addict. That didn't happen. It's not how it happens. My son made it through high school as an A student, an athlete. He was captain of the ski team, played tennis. I caught him smoking pot and freaked out, as most Jewish mothers would. And Viking and I spent a lot of time with my son, and he did really well, I thought, for a really long time. That started to change when he graduated and decided that he really needed to try every drug there was out there. And between senior year of high school and graduating with honors and getting into his top choice college and going to college, he did try a lot of drugs. He really changed, started isolating himself. I knew something was wrong, but I just didn't know what it was. I would say, as a parent, you know your kid better than anyone. And when you get that feeling in your gut that says, they're not being just a pain in the ass teenager, there's something else going on here. Talk to them about it. Talk to other people about it. Talk to their friends about it. Talk to their siblings about it. Talk to your doctor about it. When their friends change, when the way they communicate or they stop communicating with you changes. Another thing that I can't stress enough, Susan brought up earlier, lock up your prescriptions. When I was asked to talk tonight, the first person I called was Woody and said, what did I miss? What was the biggest thing? He said, Mom, you hurt your back. You had Percocet in the medicine cabinet. Yeah, I did. Not until he found it. If you have prescription drugs in your house that were prescribed to you or a member of your family, do this whole community a favor. Take them to the Plymouth PD. If you're not using them, put them in the drop box. Get rid of them. Somebody will find them. Somebody will use them, and that person can become addicted to them. When your children are given prescriptions, my son was an honor student. He was an athlete. He was a pretty responsible kid. He went to school every day. He made A's and B's. He got a C in honors chemistry, but, you know, honors chemistry is hard. He was prescribed liquid oxycodone and Vicodin after having his tonsils out. And he said, hey, you know, I'm 16. I can monitor and give myself my own medications. And that's when he started abusing them. One of the things that I've come away from this experience, Woody's been sober for a year. We couldn't get him the help we needed here in New Hampshire. He went to Arizona to a place called A Sober Way Home, and they have saved his life. And he has a great community out there of support. He's back in college. We just found out that he was accepted into an art therapy master's program, so I'm very proud of him. And every day, I know that he wakes up and he says thank you to all of the people and to himself, because he's grateful that he's sober and he doesn't want to use. One of the things that he said to me when I went out for our family support workshop in the summer is what I'd like to leave you with, is that experimenting with drugs was a choice. Kids experiment. It's a choice. When he became addicted, it was no longer a choice. He couldn't stop. So let's limit what our kids have available to experiment with. You wouldn't leave a loaded gun sitting on your kitchen counter. Don't leave a bottle of prescription, Oxy or Percocet, in your medicine cabinet. Thank you.
Hey, I just asked for another hand of applause for these two ladies. No. Knowing both these young men and bright and talented and gifted, I know Woody far better. He's my patient, and we shared some of this journey, and we shared some tears, and some sense of frustration and loss, and our hands feeling tied together. It's difficult. I have a couple things to say, and I'll try to keep under the 4 minutes real fast. So we have a good team up front helping us with that. One, there is some changes in laws that would help prevent the issue that happened for Carl. And when I go into my office and I have to write a prescription, if I'm going to write a prescription for a narcotic at this point, I need to provide a specific written piece of information about that medicine and that it is a narcotic and its potential harms. And I think that is a huge change. I'm not a huge fan of regulation if you talk to me other ways, but it's one of those things that really can make a difference, because it's very tricky as a physician in these situations because there are so many other things going on at once. So the voices that come out, the testimony shared here are really important, and those changes happen. I'm going to give, now this is sort of dating me as my cultural references are now retired, so it's saving from David Letterman of the top 10. And before I do that, I just want to highlight also knowing these two ladies next to me, they're good parents. They do a lot of these things. They did a lot of these things. So this is not a platitude and criticism, but there are some simple things we can do. And one is setting expectations. I think Alex's story of saying, gee, this happened in middle school, be very clear with your kids. Model it, My kids heard from me over and over again, I want you home safe, sober, and a virgin. I got this eye roll. We were going to do like sportswear with SSV. My younger son was going to put a condom over the V. You know, a few years of therapy, they're fine. You try to model those expectations, well, sort of. Follow through. You really have to address the behavior. You have to treasure the child at the same time. We're all knuckleheads at times. I have been, I've failed as parents at a time, and you pick yourself up, you say you're sorry, you move forward. Setting limits is not an easy job as a parent. There's actually a kid who is connected to all of these, or both those young men in certain ways through family and relationships, described the role of a mother being a fun sucker. And I would wear that prize with pride. So trust but verify. Listen to the words, but listen to others. Listen to what other people say, what's happening. At the same time, trying to respect privacy. One word of wisdom that I had gotten, I actually got attributed that I said this, but I didn't, is don't break the relationship. There are times when it's going to be very difficult with your children. At times you just have to walk away, but at the same time, don't give up. Realize that we're all works in progress. We strive to do better. We try to teach our kids how to manage challenging emotions and feelings. I don't envy being in middle school again. I have no desire to be there. I'd be pretty good at it now, but it's a really tough place to be. Another really important thing and worth reflecting on is as parents, we have to get our own stuff together. The greatest gift we can give is our kids a security that they can trust we're acting in their best interest. And it's not always easy to do that if we're dealing with our own emotions, our anxiety, our fear, our own substance issues, our own grief, being a sandwich generation between, you know, aging parents and children. But sometimes we really have to take that time to take care of ourselves. We have to forgive. We have to be involved. And now come up, it's really important. I'm getting to the top two. And one is realize we have influence but not control. And I think it's one of the things Woody taught me over those years. You have some influence, but you clearly don't have control. You know, they're my
son.
I know what he would share with me. You know, I know what my own kids were sharing with me. But we can't control it. And there's genes in there, there's family history, there's early childhood experiences that all influence of how decisions are made. We also know that early things happening in life change how we hardwire our brain. It's a really fascinating area of research that what happens when you're 2 weeks old, 4 weeks old, changes how your DNA folds. It changes what genes are transcribed and what wiring happens. And being able to treasure your kids from the beginning, which is my number one, is treasure your children. And that means for better, for worse. It doesn't mean they always get what they want. It doesn't mean that you believe everything they say, but you treasure them through thick and thin, through times of joy and times of trouble. So I'll leave at that note. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Barbara Kelly. I'm a school nurse at Newfound Regional High School. I'm celebrating 44 years as a registered nurse and have spent about half of those years in the school system as a school nurse for 16 and as a teacher for 4. I can tell you that school nursing has changed a lot in the past years. Right now we have students with a lot more complex medical needs. We have students coming to school on chemotherapy, being delivered through ports in their chest. We have students on diabetics that are on insulin pumps. We have students with seizures. But I have to say that I never really imagined that at this point we would be taking a needleless syringe, removing the cap, putting an atomizer on, and spraying it into the nostrils of an overdosed student, visitor, parent, or faculty. But this is the new reality, and we have to be prepared for it. So I think the nursing organizations, the National Association of School Nurses, the New Hampshire School Nurses, have done a wonderful job helping us to develop policies and procedures to meet the changing needs in the schools. I know some schools have already, the larger schools have already have these policies in place. I know Laconia does, Manchester, Nashua, Keene, and other ones are beginning to. I've attended a few trainings. There's another one this Saturday. They're having another training for school nurses to help develop better policies than what we have in place now. I was asked by students from a journalist class just last week asking, how did I feel about the possibility, would I be willing to give Narcan? And absolutely, I told them yes. And they asked why I'd want to do something like that. And I told them, because you need to save lives. And they said, well, what about the cost of the medication? And I said, you can't put a price on the cost of a life. So I think it was educating students as well as staff members. We talked a little bit, too, that we need to erase the stigmatism of addiction, that addicts aren't bad people trying to be good people. They're sick people trying to be healthy. And that drugs use and abuse touches everyone. It touches the youth, it touches adults, and even the elderly in our community. It's a community problem. So how do I, as a school nurse, help to make a difference? I think we educate kids about the dangers of drugs. We educate parents about the dangers of opiates and how to properly store them. We know that they're most often prescribed, usually for student athletes or someone with an injury or possibly after tooth extraction. I talked to the students. I asked them, what were they prescribed for their meds? How many were they given? How many have they taken? How many do they have left? What's their pain level? Could they talk to their doctor and ask for that special magic formula of combining acetaminophen and ibuprofen that would give them the same relief as an opioid, but without the effects? I also have an advisory of probably 12 students or so, and I'd love to see it school-wide. I became a yoga teacher this summer. I work with them on stress reduction, mindfulness, meditation, and it really has helped an awful lot. I know in New Hampshire we're seeing about 129 deaths, or we're seeing in the U.S. 129 deaths a day. New Hampshire does have the third largest drug-related deaths per capita in America, and it's highest in the Lakes region in southern New Hampshire. 27.2% of teens report feeling sad and hopelessness, and I have to say with the yoga, it is teaching kids that they can take those feelings and by certain positions and breathing, having them have those feel-good hormones released, that they can do it at any time and not need to use any drugs. In the 2015 Youth Risk Survey, Behavior Survey, 7.6% of grade 9, 11.5% of grade 10, 16.1% of grade 11, and 17.9% of grade 12 have used opioids without having a prescription of their own for it. So how can we help? Schools do need help. We need more guidance counselors. We need medical social workers. We need licensed alcohol and drug counselors. We need resource officers. We need parents. So let's work together, because it truly does take a village to raise a child. Thank you.
I'm Mike Currier, and I'm a school social worker at Plymouth Regional High School. I call myself the director of drama and trauma. And it is on a daily basis. There's all kinds of things going on with kids today. There's a million things out there that create stress, worry, the whole nine yards. And, you know, I think listening to all the... like, usually I'm too loud.
Closer
to me, okay. I've always wanted to play the monkey, and now I get a chance to. But, but you know, we can see that the drug use is a complex, complex thing. There's family history, there's stress, there's peer pressure, there's pleasure. There are a lot of things that go into kids using. I can tell you an experience I had. I think it was my second year. I've been there about 7 years at the high school, but I got talking to three or four different girls, and they all had different issues of anxiety. There was a family that had divorced, and there was a boyfriend in and a girlfriend in, and it was kind of crazy. Little brothers being a pain in the neck, and this girl was just stressed to the max. There was another girl whose dad was dying of cancer, and he was losing limbs along the way, and you know, she was coming all the time crying. And these four girls were all very, very bright. They are out of school now, and they're all doing well. But coming through that to them, I asked them, I said, what do you guys do? How do you make it? You guys are incredible. And what they would do is they'd meet together at one girl's grandmother's house, and they'd go up in the attic, and they'd smoke a bowl of pot. They'd smoke some weed. You know, and I thought about that, and I thought, well, how much different is that from us adults that after a hard day's work, we get down to happy hour, have a couple beers, and go home to dinner? So kids kind of look at that as a way to share time, hang out, forget about all the things going on in their life. So it's really become kind of a natural thing, and you would be amazed at what kind of kids and how many different types of kids that are using. And maybe not, you know, to the degree we're talking about here, but it all starts somewhere. So it's out there everywhere, and you can't get around it. I want to ask you all, too, to kind of reflect tonight about your ability to deal with stress, to look back to see, how did I learn how to deal with stress? What were my examples growing up in dealing with hard times, stress? Am I resilient? Am I not? What did I get? Who did I get it from? And I think that when you look back, we probably, none of us really got, you know, what we got was my dad would tell me, well, you made your own bed, you lie in it. And then he'd say, you know, you figure it out and that sort of thing. And I had to kind of figure out how to be resilient. And I get stressed every day. So it worked to a point. But I think the other thing kids talk about is that their parents often, when they talk to their parents about, I'm stressed out, I can't handle this, I broke up with my boyfriend or my girlfriend. And a parent often responds like, you don't know what stress is. Well, everybody's stress is relative to your own experience. And if your own experience at 8 years old is that your puppy died, it's pretty traumatic. So the level of trauma for an 8-year-old or a 12-year-old or a 35-year-old are different things, but it doesn't mean it's any less stressful. It doesn't mean it's any less painful. So I think as parents, we need to take a look and recognize that this is pretty important stuff and that we are all walking examples to our kids as to how to deal with things. Babies learn to interact with their parents as to what they're seeing. You know, you can smile at a baby and goo and ga, and they respond to you like that. You stop talking to them, they get a little uncomfortable. I mean, babies and kids are looking to figure things out. And when they watch their parents at home losing their stuff because mom didn't pay the bill or dad didn't, you know, came home late or whatever, and they see craziness at home or they see people fretting over things, that's what they're learning. You know, and I'm not saying we're blaming the parents, because I think all through history, parents haven't really thought about that as much because they didn't really reflect and see, how is that going to impact my kid? But we're walking examples for our kids, and our kids are going to do a lot of the things that we do. And as they get older, they get more influenced by whoever their closest friends are. How much time do I have? 1 minute. Okay, so I want to go right to the plan and how to deal with this. You know, my recommendations are that, you know, we have the best intentions as parents, but I think sometimes we're a little too overbearing. I think we need to teach our kids to make good choices, make good decisions, be there to guide them, and just not hover so much. We can hover from a distance, perhaps, because we got to keep an eye on things. But I think the more we do for our kids, the more we take them out of the decision-making situation, I think we're not doing them a justice. And when they're older, they have to make their own choices. And when the kids decide, am I going to smoke dope, or am I going to just go home? You know, that's when the things are going to kick in, what they've learned from a young age. So it starts from birth. And you talk about prevention, early intervention. That means day one of life. And as Viking mentioned earlier, 2 weeks old, 4 weeks old, a month old, year old, you know, at different levels, cognitively, they bring in different things. So I would say build a support system with your kids when they're young. Have that uncle, aunt, friend, or whatever, somebody that when your kids are getting ticked off at you because you're the one who's setting down the rules, they can vent to somebody that they trust and care for who's going to be safe for them. So do the things you need to do, build a support system, be honest with them, share the truth about things, and just, you know, all the time you let them know you love them. So that's it. I'm out of time. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Steve LaFave. I'm the chief of police here in the metropolis of Plymouth. I'd like to take this time to talk about juvenile crime as it relates to alcohol and drugs and our restorative justice program. For those of you who don't know, restorative justice is an alternative program to juvenile court. Conventional juvenile court is strictly punitive. All it does is label a juvenile as a delinquent, does not hold them accountable for their actions, or even teach them about personal responsibility. Our restorative justice program at C.A.D.Y is a comprehensive program that educates juveniles on risk, shows them how to make positive choices, and teaches them responsibility, all while holding them accountable for their actions. Restorative justice promotes growth and fosters lasting behavioral change. The bottom line is it works, and it works far better than conventional juvenile justice court. And why do I bring this up? I bring this up, and the reason why I chose to talk about restorative justice is because I believe that it's a very valuable resource and available to everybody and every family in this community. If you suspect your child is involved in drugs and alcohol, they probably are. Talk to your school or your local police department about making a referral to restorative justice. Early intervention is the key to preventing arrest, preventing adjudication, and most importantly, preventing addiction. Thank you.
You just got a few extra minutes. A bonus, yeah.
For the last 13 years, I've had the privilege of co-facilitating the FASTER Parent Support Group in Manchester, and FASTER is an acronym for Families Advocating Substance Treatment Education and Recovery. And we meet every Tuesday evening. When we started 13 years ago, the room had about, six or seven parents in it, all of whose children were smoking pot, skipping school, not keeping curfew, and generally misbehaving at home. Oh, thank you. And last week when I looked over the room of 23 parents, all of them were dealing with opiate and heroin and alcohol. One of the things I would wish for is that we would get parents in who are knowing that their child is, quote, just smoking pot. Every single parent in that room said, my child started with pot. And Alex's story tonight certainly brought that home. We know that every child who smokes a joint is not going to go on to be a heroin addict. But we also know that one out of six, or 16%, are going to have a predisposition to it. And one out of 11 adults, and that's 9%. And it's only different because the adult brain is fully developed. Our children's brains aren't developed until they're 25. And that makes a huge difference. When an organ is going through development, it is much more susceptible to adverse effects. That's why we want to get it early. So if you're a parent who is saying, well, my kid doesn't smoke, doesn't do heroin right now, and I know he's smoking pot, and I smoked pot in high school, I turned out okay. You got to understand that the pot concentration is a whole lot different. It used to be 4 to 6%. It's now 15 to 20%, and some kids know how to make it stronger than that. So coming out early is a really good thing because that's when you can learn to intervene, as all of us parents wish we learned that really early. I will tell you that every parent that comes into the parent group has a tremendous sense of fear, shame, embarrassment, undeserved. Totally undeserved. If your child had cancer, you would not be happy about that. It would be very sad for you, but you also wouldn't hesitate to come out to a parent support group. This shame, embarrassment is undeserved. You did not cause this any more than you caused any other chronic relapsing illness. If you could cure it and control it, you would have done that already. You need help in doing that. Coming out and being with other parents really gives an opportunity to be in an atmosphere that does not judge you, has resources and information to supply you. And the group wisdom of people who are in the trenches doing it has experience of what worked, what hasn't worked, and you can really benefit from that. 2 years ago, I was asked to expand the parent groups around the state, and I'm very happy to tell you that you now have a FASTER parent support group right here in Plymouth down at the Community Villages, and it meets on the first and the third Wednesday of the month, and there are flyers in the back. And you've got a trained facilitator who's a parent. You've got wonderful resources here through Katie and a lot of opportunity to be heard and to know what can help your situation. And one of the things I also want to say to you is that what are you doing to take care of yourselves? Parenting is such an intense job. It doesn't give you time off. It's a 24/7. And learning how to take care of yourself. And I would just leave you with, what are you going to do for yourself 1 hour this week that has nothing to do with thinking or talking about drugs, your job, or maintaining your house? What are you going to do that's totally for you? 1 hour this week. Try it.
Thank you. I just wanted to thank all of the panel members. You were phenomenal, especially Susan and Janice. Your courage to come out and speak is just, it's a gift. Thank you. I just want to just give you a sense of Katie and what we do. We've been working with our communities for the past 17 years to prevent substance misuse and to build healthy foundations and promising futures for youth in the Pemi Baker, the Newfound, and the Lincoln Woodstock regions. And we also serve as the Regional Prevention Network for Central New Hampshire. So why is substance abuse prevention so important? I have a chart to show. I'm not sure if it's going to actually, if you can see it on the screen, Liz. Oh, maybe you won't see it. But what it shows, it shows the escalation of drug use between the ages of 12 to 20, and it's just a surge. The trajectory of use is unbelievable. And then what you see over the lifespan, it starts tapering off. And according to the National Center on Addiction and Substance Abuse, 9 out of 10 individuals who struggle with addiction began drinking, smoking, and using other drugs before they turned 18 years of age. And research also shows that those who do start using drugs before the age of 15 are 6 times more likely to develop addiction in adulthood. That's because, as you've heard from several speakers, a teen's brain is developing until the age of 25, which makes them much more vulnerable to having their brain rewired for addiction. And that's why addiction is known as a disease of adolescence. If you could see this pipeline, I call it the addiction pipeline, and we all know that if we can prevent youth substance use, we can begin to shut down the addiction pipeline, and that's something that we need to be doing. You've heard from so many, we can't incarcerate our way out of this. We cannot treat our way strictly out of this. We have to really use a continuum of care, and that means we take the prevention, intervention, treatment, and recovery and work in concert with each other in order to be able to really fully address this issue. You heard Tim speaking to that earlier. Our speakers have all shared many effective prevention strategies so far, but what I really want you to know is parents are the first line of defense, and you are the greatest deterrent to youth substance use. You can keep your child, if you really fully appreciate that, and so many parents don't. We underestimate the power of our influence. We know from the youth in the Pemi Baker and the Newfound regions, from their reporting through the youth assessments, that if their parents have clear guidelines on on use. You disapprove. You communicate that to your children. They are 77% less likely to use. And that's very powerful. So remember that when you discount yourself and think that peers are more important. On this subject matter, you are. And parents still rule. I also want to let you know that a good protective factor is keeping your children connected to pro-social opportunities in the community, whether that be school athletics, theater, other school-related clubs, the Pemi Youth Center, the Tapley Thompson Community Center over in Bristol. C.A.D.Y also has several youth programs, the Launch Youth Employment Program. Many of your kids may be involved with that or will be at some point in time. That's our collaboration with Alex Ray and the Common Man Inn. Going into our 12th year. It's very, very outstanding programming. And we also have a youth leadership program, the YAC program, that won the New Futures Statewide Award for the Youth in Action. We're very proud of all of these kids and their peer leaders. Restorative justice, you heard Chief speak to that, that we know that sometimes good kids make bad choices. And if kids don't deserve a second chance, I really don't know who does. So that's what we do. We work with kids, and it's an outstanding program that promotes growth. We have the Circle program. There's so many wonderful programs and resources for you to take advantage of and connect your kids to. I also want to let you know that there's some resources in the back of the room. There's the Nancy Jackson Reno is here from the Partnership for Drug-Free New Hampshire, and the Check the Stats NH.org campaign website is a powerful tool for parents. Please check that out and access that when you can. I also have something here that a colleague of mine designed in Southern New Hampshire, and Betsy Hood, and this is phenomenal. It's a quiz for parents, but really what it is, it's a tool on how to raise healthy children in a culture of alcohol and drug use. It's amazing. I took this quiz, and please, when you leave tonight, we have some of our youth that'll be at the door. Make sure you grab one and take it. It's going to give you a lot of insights into yourself, the messaging. You know, are you sending the message you really intend to? Is it being received on the other end by your kids? You don't have to share your score with anyone. It's just between you and this little quiz. But please take it. It's your takeaway for the evening, along with all this great advice that you received on parenting tips. Please keep in mind, I know you've heard that, but I just want to reiterate that all drug use, including marijuana and alcohol, pose a health and safety risk to our children and youth in the short term and in the long term. It's a risk multiplier for heroin addiction. We know that when kids use marijuana, and we have a marijuana dispensary coming to town, so I'm going to ask you to make sure you keep perception of risk high, because when kids get mixed messages, they think it's the green light to use. So we want to make sure we keep our kids safe. Marijuana use and addiction can predispose kids to three times towards heroin addiction. That's pretty scary. Prescription drugs, 40 times. These are the kind of things that we know through science, and that we're available, you know, to share that information with you at any time. Always feel free to stop by the C.A.D.Y office. If we don't have the information at hand, we will find out, and we will refer you to the resource that it best fits your need. So I want to leave you with the fact that it's absolutely impossible for us just to know everything you need to know about prevention, treatment, or recovery. None of us know. It's a moving target all the time, even the experts in the field. But What you need to know more than anything is where do you turn for the resources? And that's where you're going to be able to get the answers. You've heard the experts tonight. We don't want you to learn the hard way. We want to prevent whenever possible. And that's why we named tonight's event, Teach Our Children Well. Because you've also heard that it's a community commitment and responsibility. You're not alone. So individually, they're your children. Collectively, they're our children. So always, always know there's a place to go. Thank you so much. And I do, before I turn this over to our MC, I want you to know that all of the speakers will be available to meet with you one-on-one after the session tonight. So we'll be up towards the stage. Feel free to come up and have a chat. Thanks.
Great. Thank you. Big hand for the panel again. Thank you very much. I'm going to stand in front of you all. Again, I want to thank all of you for coming out tonight, the panel, Susan, Janice, Alex, for bringing their personal stories to this. We are going to have some time for some sort of mingling and socializing and connecting. There's an evaluation form on the back of your form, and Katie would love you to fill out. I have two things I want to leave you with. The first is your voice matters. I hope that you heard that in a lot of what you heard by speakers tonight. Your voice matters to your children, it matters to your community, it matters to your elected officials. I spend my time in Concord doing some of the work with that eloquent list of things that need to change in the broken system that Susan spoke about. And I will tell you that your voice influencing those folks you send to Concord is important, and it matters. It matters to them, those who are fighting for this work down in Concord. So I really hope you take some of these messages home, and not only to your family and neighbors, but to your elected officials as well. The second thing is this. I spoke at an event as well in Bedford. It was noted. I live in Bedford, that's my hometown. And there was a woman in recovery who spoke on the panel that I was on. And one of the stories she shared is, in preparing to speak to that group of parents, she went out and talked to a number of folks at the recovery center that she spends a lot of time at and that she teaches yoga at down in Manchester. And she asked them, because the panel was for parents of elementary school students, she asked them, what would you say to your 11-year-old self? As a person in long-term recovery, if you could go back and say one thing to your 11-year-old self, what would that be? And she said, unsolicited, to a person, they said the exact same thing. I would tell my 11-year-old self, they're okay just as they are. And that message is the most important message you can give as a parent, and only a parent can give it. So I hope you take those messages to heart. I hope you take advantage of the information that's out there. Please stay connected with Katie. The work they're doing in this region, that these leaders in the region is doing, is so critically important, but it only succeeds if the community is with them. So I hope you continue to engage with that. And with that, I think there is a closing video. Yes?